went down to the River Jordan, where John baptized three. When I walked the devil in hell, says Johnny baptized me. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Oh, now roll, Jordan, roll. My soul will rise in heaven, Lord, for the year, Jordan, roll.
All right. I think you guys should be able to see the screen. I'm Kelly Jones. I am very proud of that recent promotion. Associate professor went into effect like over the summer. I just changed my email signature. So that means it's official. Yay. Thanks, y'all. So I'm originally from Northern Conway County. So I am a native Arkansan. And sometimes that helps when people find my message uncomfortable. It helps. It's like, my people did it too. You know, it's kind of break the ice a little bit with that. My first professor job was out in Middle Tennessee at a small school called Austin Peay State University. And then when Tom DeBlack retired at Arkansas Tech, I could not resist the opportunity to come back home and talk about the research that's really close to a cause, really, you know, for me, and pop around the state and get to talk about it. So I feel like I'm living a dream right now. I was in Pocahontas last week, almost a week ago, or a little over a week ago. I was in Pocahontas talking about this kind of stuff as well. So I'm loving it. So I hope you guys will humor me here for a second while I do a little commercial for the book, if it's not too shameless. The book is published by the University of Georgia Press. And so you can go on ugapress.org to get a copy of this book, A Weary Land, Slavery on the Ground in Arkansas. You can punch in a discount code. And if you've gone to or tuned into different talks in the past, the code looked different. They changed it up, okay, every once in a while. So I don't know what that's about. But right now, and I've tested this recently, okay, as of a week ago, it was still working. 08CLAS will give you a discount on this. Now, this is especially helpful right now because you guys may know that university press books are pricey to produce and therefore pricey when you buy them. So the hardback copy was somewhere around $60, really putting it out of the reach of students. And so the it is sold enough, apparently, okay, that they've moved to paperback, which will be available in just a couple of weeks, is what I'm told. So, you know, if you want your best bang for your buck, like with the percentage, I guess, you know, maybe get the hardback. But I'm just saying, if you want your overall cost like to be lower, if you apply the discount to the paperback, then it just changes the game on accessibility for people.
Yes.
Yay. Okay. Yes. So the short version is newer, harsher version of slavery is now in Arkansas and they're making a lot of money. Okay.
Gotcha.
Okay. Although there's a little more drama than that. All right, so that positive good defense of slavery is intense. That's the one we recognize, right? When you're looking at, when people think about the cotton plantation South and the coming of the Civil War and just that intense desire to keep that going. That's in Arkansas and that's in all parts of Arkansas. I can hit you with some numbers on this. If you're interested in Washington County in particular, let me get my little cheat sheet. There were more than 1,400 enslaved people in Washington County at that 1860 census. That's that last one that we get right before the Civil War. That's out of 14, you know, not quite 15,000 people in the county as a whole. So I just heard a buzzing stop and that made me nervous, but it's back. So I feel like nothing.
It's our sound.
Okay, so we're good. Okay, sometimes it means something died. So this second slavery is relying on that Western acreage expansion, okay? And so that means that it can't be disconnected from the history of Indian removal. So Indian removal, what people will refer to the Trail of Tears, which is sort of one sliver of that very long, okay, process. You cannot disentangle that from the movement of the second slavery across the American South. Because what people who have power are trying to do is make that land, in their views, empty. legally empty. Okay. So pushing Native American people off of that acreage so they can push African descended people onto it. Okay. So that process is all linked together. I think for most people, the most recognizable moment in that history is that Indian Removal Act of 1830. It's going to set in motion the conclusion of that longer process of clearing Native Americans under their tribal governments, okay, out of places like Arkansas, pushing them through Arkansas, right? And so I've got a local example here for you to point out that white business owners and the sort of infrastructure that whites are looking to put up out here on the southern frontier benefits from federal funds granted to those in Arkansas that want to facilitate journeys of Native Americans across the state. Maurice Wright was a slaveholding merchant out in Cane Hill. And in the 1830s, he's got this partnership with his brother selling pork to the newly arriving Cherokees, like just right there close. A citizen writing to the Arkansas Gazette in this era spoke for most whites in expressing this vision of Arkansas no longer as this wilderness, okay, doing the air quotes. Oh, you guys can see me now. Doing the air quotes, wilderness in their view of savages, but instead making it an agrarian paradise where, quote, the earth is made to perform the offices for which she was intended by the God of nature. Slavery shaped the constructs of Arkansas's political boundaries while pressing a fingerprint into the landscape itself. Slavery and enslaved people defined Arkansas's ground in the lowlands and the upcountry alike. Enslaved Black farmers built Arkansas's predominantly agricultural economy, enriching the region's most prominent leaders. So any place you can look and see sort of those early trading posts in Arkansas history, dig a little deeper and you can probably find a slaveholding merchant who's sort of getting his start. And it's usually him, okay, out here. I've got the Jacob Wolf example of this. I don't know if anybody around here has been to the Jacob Wolf house. Enslaved people built that place. And they built the wealth of Jacob Wolf, this early prominent Arkansan. He's got a spot there where the White and North Fork Rivers come together there in Izard County. Now it's Baxter County, but it was Izard County then. I don't want anybody on the internet to get me, okay, on that. He probably brought enslaved people with him when he got here in Arkansas. He held 76 acres by 1829. 10 years later, at least 4 enslaved people lived on this site, and he had expanded to more than 250 acres. By 1850, the enslaved people at Wolf's Place numbered at least 12, doubling by 1860. And they lived there, if the census is to be believed, in 3 cabins. Sometimes the census takers not good at counting cabins for enslaved people. So it's a little tricky. The Wolf Place was a trading post. It was a crossroads. It was a political center. So that means that enslaved people would have witnessed and facilitated all of this with their labor. This house, as one of Arkansas's early economic and political hubs, is a place where a lot of people are coming and going. They're exchanging political ideas, they're settling appointments, they're delivering speeches. A meeting in 1850 that Wolf held and chaired, actually, for, quote, Southern rights is something they would have witnessed, and they would have heard him advocate that Arkansans participate in that famous or notorious, I guess, Nashville convention to argue for their sacred rights to the labor of African descended people. So yes, it's everywhere in Arkansas and fundamental, even here, y'all, even here in Northwest Arkansas. I fight that battle a lot down in the River Valley because I'll have some students from up here come down to Arkansas Tech and say, oh, well, but you know, up in Northwest Arkansas, it's not really that big. It's not important, you know, or, you know, whatever. And so I have to work on that a lot. Often I will remind the Fayetteville people that the enslaved population in Fayetteville was an even higher proportion than of the state as a whole. So by the time you get to 1860, 1 in 4 Arkansans is held in chattel slavery. In Fayetteville, it's a third. Now, the population of Fayetteville is small. It's like, is it even 1,000? But so percentages can really look, you know, but just saying, okay? So if you want to, we've got that to think about. One of my favorite examples is Peter Van Winkle, the Peter Van Winkle complex, not just because his name is fun to say. You've got several people lived, enslaved people living on that creek, right? They're close to the White River. They're doing this labor building Northwest Arkansas, right? From Van Winkle's mill complex. He's born in New York. He began amassing that land in Washington County, Benton County, Carroll County, beginning in certainly by the 1840s. He's got some acreage out there. By 1850, he established this complex on the North Fork of the Little Clifty Creek in War Eagle Township. And I think that's named after the Kentucky. There's a Little Clifty and a Big Clifty in Kentucky. So I think it's one of those things that we talk about, like you could kind of, by the place name, sort of follow these people's routes here. By 1860, 13 enslaved people lived and worked at the Van Winkle complex. That's including 5 adult men, 2 adult women. That number gets to at least 18 by 1861. That's a pretty concentrated enslaved community for this part of the state. Most historians think of 20 enslaved people as like the sort of cutoff on whether we call something a plantation or not. That's imperfect because, as you can imagine, the experience of an operation where 20 enslaved people live is very different from the experience of a population of enslaved people where maybe there's like 120, but you know, we do what we can with that. But that's a pretty high number for this area. Between 1810 and 1860, more than 80,000 enslaved people were forced into Arkansas. I forgot to show you guys Jacob Wolf cabin. That's like a little bit later, but it looks basically like that still if you guys go out there. So it gets to over 111,000. It's a quarter of the state's population. There are about 11,000 enslavers, okay, in Arkansas at that 1860 count. So this is an increase in the enslaved population in Arkansas of 136% between the 1850 count and the 1860 count. It's huge. The only place where slavery was growing faster than Arkansas in those years is like this chunk of East Texas. I'm talking about in the United States. Slavery is growing faster nowhere else than Arkansas, except I don't want Randolph Campbell after me, right? Like that, it's like, what is that, Harrison County and the, you know, over there. So of course they're invested in this. They're making a lot of money. We said that the defense of slavery has become very energetic. And so there is of course brutality used to protect the economy and society here. So slavery, chattel slavery begins, of course, as a labor control, a labor exploitation system. But it's lasted so long by now, certainly with that injection of the second slavery, right, that sort of new form, that now it's also a form of racial control. It's more than just the labor is what it means to, you know, that society. So the way that white Southerners, Arkansans included, think about who they are, who their family is, what the world should be like, how they interpret their Bible, okay, all of that. Their ideas about womanhood and manhood, all of that is touched, okay, by the existence of this. So it's so deep. And so that helps us to understand why they protect it so fiercely. There is in this book a host of examples of brutality against enslaved people. I think that you could go there to read those kinds of things. What I want to point out here is that brutality in protecting not just slavery, but white supremacy overall, right, is also existing here in Northwest Arkansas. The sort of go-to examples for us are the Boone lynching outside of Fayetteville in 1856, which folks up here have done yeoman's work in digging up details that we didn't have before. There was a woman, an enslaved woman lynched in 1840 named Carolyn. They describe her as a girl, but that could mean, you know, she could have been 65, right? But it's just a diminutive way to describe enslaved people. So the Ozarks are just as committed, okay, to this as anywhere else in Arkansas or the South. Now, it gets complicated when you talk about the sectional crisis, right? We know that this part of the state is a, it's kind of like the Tennessee example, you know, where like East Tennessee and West Tennessee are not, they didn't quite agree either in the sectional crisis. Northwest Arkansas and certainly those planters down in Southeast Arkansas didn't exactly agree. Doesn't mean that they're any less committed to slavery or white supremacy up here. It's just, what are they willing to do and who are they willing to follow, right, to make that happen? One example that I've got here that another member of y'all's group, I chatted with him after the Statehood Day talk. Now I can't think of his name, but he's been researching this minister named Anthony Bewley. This is a white minister who came through Fayetteville and was suspected of being an abolitionist, and he gets run out of town. So anyway, well, here we go. I'll quit eventually, I promise. But they worried that, and this is 1860, he gets run out of town, and he makes the mistake of stopping in Benton County. And everybody sort of finds out that this perhaps abolitionist is around. And he had given some, he had led at least one convention, like religious convention up here in the past. So he wasn't like some unknown guy that was already, you know, sort of under suspicion or something. But according to the Fayetteville Arkansian, this guy, once they let him go, and you know, they chained him up in Fayetteville for at least a night, and they let him go, sort of drop him in Fort Smith, and he gets down into Texas, and I think the white Texans ended up hanging him. If the Fayetteville Arkansian article is, you know, can be taken at face value. There's, you know, who knows? There's probably more details to that. So the commitment is everywhere. I hope I've gotten you sold on that. Okay, let's talk about tension. Okay, because I'm spending a lot of time talking about the regime that, okay, let me do, okay, the regime that whites are trying to create in Arkansas. But this book is really about that tension between them, okay? What white Arkansans, what their designs are for the ground of Arkansas and how enslaved people push back against that, complicate that, right? Sort of make up their own understandings of what does this land mean? What can this landscape do, okay, for me? One point I always like to make is that the ideas that people have about plantation homes and such doesn't really fit the frontier Arkansas experience. It doesn't really fit like the North Louisiana experience either, or, you know, some other areas. I remember being frustrated when I watched 12 Years a Slave about the story of Solomon Northup. They said at that plantation with the wrought iron, remember like the railings and all this stuff, I'm like, they're on the Red River in like 1845 or something. I'm like, no, it looked probably not even this good. I mean, I don't know. Okay. So this is the frontier. 19th century Americans, white or black, think that the area west of the Mississippi is just the edge of the civilized world. Okay. There are Americans now who think that crossing the Mississippi River has you on the edge of the civilized world. The reputation is an old one, okay? We're out here in the sticks. Yes, the wealth is there. They're putting the wealth in land. They're putting the wealth in enslaved people. Not enough time has passed for them to have gotten a chance to spend as much time performing that wealth with those big Greek revival, the kind of things that people think of when they think like a plantation home. And so I wanted to point out here, and actually, this is one of y'all's photos. And I'm thinking, like, I think there was a form I was supposed to fill out, like to allow me to use this, like in a PowerPoint. So we can talk about that. This is the William Wilson House. And this is what it looks like during the war, right after the war. Like, this is 1860s, okay? But right up until then, so they're building this during the war, okay? Right up until then, this is the action they've got going on. Obviously, it wasn't falling in, okay, like that. But this is the basic structure, okay? This is where they're living. And then when they get the other house finished, this is where enslaved people are living. This is out, this is Washington County. This is also true in all parts of the state, okay? One thing to remember is that the most common slaveholding size in Arkansas, whether you're looking at the northwest corner, the northeast corner, you know, every quadrant, okay, of the state, southeast Arkansas, Delta Country included, the most frequent slaveholding farm size is small. It's 1 or 2, 3, 5, okay, maybe when you get further down, okay. And so the more humble material circumstances for the whites as slaveholders is going to be the more typical experience. I'm not pointing that out to somehow lessen the harsh reality for enslaved people, okay? But just to point out that this is not that sort of Hollywood version of like the plantation South. This is the southern frontier. We're on the margins of the cotton South or the corn South, okay, cattle South, okay, all of those things that that are making people money at this time. Okay, sorry, I snuck that in, I had forgotten. But this tension is really what I want to talk about. It's really the heart of the book. Whites are trying to create this agricultural haven, right? They're trying to make good on the promises of this acreage. They're trying to create what in their mind is an orderly, civilized, okay, society. And in that definition for them, that's slaveholding, right? That's whether you're carving out that acreage for corn, whether you're putting up those fences to hold in stock, okay? Their agricultural paradise is one that's on the back of enslaved people. That's what makes the ground civilized for them, okay? Those uncultivated spaces, to use an agricultural historian term, the weeds, the bushes, okay, the swamps, those are the places that are creating fear in the minds of whites, because that's where enslaved people run off to. That's where they hide and have church services where they're preaching a subversive Black Christianity, right? Not slaves obey your masters, but there will be no such thing as slave and free in the kingdom of heaven, right? The Exodus is emphasized, okay, out there in the bushes. That's the sort of like the dark corners, okay, in this world that's supposed to be tamed, okay, and civilized for these white pioneers. And those are the places that enslaved people are going to use, you know, to their advantage. So the interesting sort of, I don't know if it's like literally irony, like if you're like a literature professor, I don't know if this fits like the definition of irony, but I'll just say it's interesting. The very thing that makes slavery so profitable in Arkansas, all of that fresh, fertile, uncultivated land for cheap, okay, all that so-called wilderness, right, to be had, the very thing that makes it profitable, the very thing that's a draw for whites, is the thing that enslaved people are going to use against them to undercut that regime. Running away in the woods is really the big example of this. They're running away into the woods and the bushes so much that the phrase "in the woods" becomes synonymous with "my slave ran away." Okay. So they'll sort of use that as like a shorthand. So you'll have runaway ads. Jimmy's in the woods. You can buy them for me if you want, if you can catch them, you know, $1,000, that kind of thing. So let's say someone's in the woods. I've got another local example here for you. A man named George fled from Matthew Leeper's place close to Fayetteville. I can't tell you exactly where this was at, but it's close to Fayetteville. And he appeals to his friends and neighbors like David Walker, the sort of largest slaveholder in like that part of the world, to help when nobody else would. And he says, quote, "Good wishes with nothing else is of but little use to a man when his Negro is in the bushes. The scoundrel George, being aware of my necessities, has taken advantage of them. Of my intended movements, I say nothing publicly, with a hope that George will think I have left the country." By cautioning discretion, he's acknowledging enslaved people like George's extensive communication networks, right? And when he says leave the country, he means leave the area. He doesn't mean like, you know, leave the country. So I opened the book with the story of a man named Reuben Johnson. Story Matt and Ron had sent me newspaper article on this guy. And it talks about he's harvesting walnuts at night so that he can pay for a book. And then he's hiding the book in the woods sort of trying to learn how to read in these secluded spaces when nobody's looking. And I'll let you read the book because I can't give everything away to see what happens to him. But this is this kind of use of the landscape around them for their own subversive ends is, you know, universal, okay, for them. So me and Becky's favorite example probably is Wesley Mecklen. So Wesley Mecklen, it's like just outside, probably in what is now, Fayetteville now is like sort of absorbed. Okay. And Wesley Mecklen, during the upheaval of the Civil War, is able to, he's foraging, he's hunting, he's selling stuff to Union soldiers. He's like doing, he's just kind of moving about. He knows the geography. He knows those public spaces. He's owning them because of the upheaval of the war. He's also very well acquainted with like the places to hunt and fish and sort of convert that, right, to his own uses. And so it's a universal experience. I happen to open with a guy who's closer to Little Rock. Let me bring up a example of how all of this is kind of turned on its head with the Civil War years, because the rules kind of change. And the juicy example that I've brought for you is a Southeast Arkansas. It's a Helena area example, but it could easily, it's a story you could easily find up here, because this is also a place where you're not sure who's going to be in power tomorrow, right? Is it going to be Confederate guerrillas that you've got to contend with? Is it going to be an actual organized unit? Okay, federal soldiers, it's sort of flipping all the time. But before I tell you the story of these guys down here south of Helena, let's point out and just make it super clear that the Confederacy was created to protect slavery. The Civil War happened because the Confederacy was created to protect slavery. And so that's the thing that they're, you know, committed to. And let me give you guys a quotation from the governor of Arkansas. When Arkansans are kind of, I should say, the people with formal political power in Arkansas are grappling with what to do here. Should we secede? Should we not? They're getting folks coming on behalf of the Confederacy, trying to romance them into, you know, joining, okay? And they're using the same kind of language here. But here's the governor of Arkansas explaining to trying to get the secession convention to go ahead and pull the trigger. And he's explaining sort of what's at stake here. And he says, the institution, and he means slavery, is now upon its trial before you. If we mean to defend and transmit it to our children, let us terminate this Northern crusade by forming a separate government in which no conflict can ensue. He says the extension of slavery is the vital point of the whole controversy between the North and the South. Does there exist inside the borders of Arkansas any diversity of sentiment as to the religious or moral right of holding Negro slaves? God, in his omnipotent wisdom, I believe, is what he says, created the cotton plant, the African slave, and the lower Mississippi Valley to clothe and feed the world, and a gallant race of men and women produced upon its soil to defend it and execute that decree. So everybody in 1861 knows exactly what this is about. Rector goes on to say that without slavery, Arkansas's fertile fields are deserts and her people penniless and impoverished. So being that as it may, okay, you've got enough people who have formal political power in Arkansas, get the reins of this and take their state out of the Union and into the arms of the Confederacy. There are a lot of other people without formal political power in Arkansas who do not support the Confederacy. There are many people who did have a political power in Arkansas who got outvoted, right? Or run out of town or whatever on that. This is why I do not, I should say it this way, I correct gently students who write about the Civil War as a conflict between North and South. Okay, recording's in progress. Sorry. The Civil War is a conflict between the United States and the Confederacy. Okay, so this is contested. There's plenty of that, okay, in the book. What I want to sort of point out is that one of the things that's interesting about this, the upheaval of the war, is that you used to have enslavers exasperated to find enslaved people hiding in the woods and the bushes and the canebrake and the swamps and all that kind of stuff. Now, guess what? They're ushering them into the woods to hide them from who? Kind of anybody. Sometimes you've got Confederate leaning folks hiding enslaved people from the feds. Okay. We don't want them, depending on what, you know, year you're talking about or month. Okay. We don't want them to know about the Emancipation Proclamation. If they see the blue coats, they're going to, you know, cause these people know exactly what's going on here. Right. And they're not waiting on Lincoln. They're running as soon as they find out, you know, anything about this. Sometimes enslavers are hiding enslaved people from the Confederates because they don't want them to be impressed for service for the Confederacy. And they don't know when they'll see them again. It might be dangerous work. And so sort of an interesting little thing here. So in the old days, okay, you're talking about people who would follow the trails that enslaved people made when they were provisioning their friends who were hiding out, okay, in the woods for a few days. Now it's the slaveholders making those trails because they're like, here's some water, like here's some, you know, cornbread or, you know, whatever the thing is, you know, sort of keeping these people from becoming free or getting in the clutches of the, you know, Confederate impressment, you know, whatever, labor, trenches, you know, that kind of stuff. And so things get interesting. So let me tell you guys the story of this deputy plantation. So this is down here close to Helena. And when they get the idea, when the enslaved people there sort of find out that federal soldiers are approaching, they're not really sure if what this is gonna mean for them. Now, on the deputy plantation, it's even weirder in some ways because Joseph Deputy was a Northerner who kind of thinks that slavery is probably going to end at some point. And he says, if you guys sort of stick around here with me on the plantation and you don't run off, then, you know, I'll try to keep you from getting pressed into labor by the Confederates and stuff. And then, you know, maybe after the war is over, we can come to some kind of like deal or something. Enough of them are more trusting in the known than the unknown that they will stick around. Not all of them, right? I mean, Helena's right there, although you don't know. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of iffy, okay? But you have a handful of folks who are, they're sticking around, okay? But here's the deal. Joseph Deputy died. So now you have a population of enslaved people on this plantation. There are Union soldiers in town, there are rebel guerrillas in the woods, and then the overseer is still on the place. And he's kind of like, should I try to keep order here? So they're farming a little bit, but it seems like things are sort of up in the air. And the overseer spends a lot of time with Confederate guerrillas and people who just may not have any loyalties at all, right? And eventually he's just gone. And this man named Alex Castile decides that he's going to stick around and try to survive and take care of his two little boys. And so when the white planter died, Alex Castile comes and takes up residence in the house, the big house, okay, the planter's home where the white family had lived. This proved too bold for the Confederate guerrillas who lurked in the area, sort of always watching what's going on. And his, Castile's recollection is that, quote, I moved up in the house, tried to stay there, but the rebels went for me there one night. And so he finally came in to Helena to get behind US lines and to what seemed like safety. So that sort of upheaval in the war is so common. It's a story you could find in all parts of, certainly up here, you know, as well, where you've got competing powers and competing interests. and things that shift. I do want to plug Amy Merle Taylor's recent book called Embattled Freedom, and it's about Black refugees in the Civil War. And she makes a really good point about historians spending a lot of time talking about the Emancipation Proclamation and emancipation as a whole as being useful, okay, to the cause of the United States. What she points out, though, is that this is linked to whatever a Union commander thinks of as military necessity. So sometimes military necessity means we stay in one spot and we will employ you in wood cutting or whatever, depending on what time we're talking about, recruiting, okay, people like Aaron Brooks, okay, to serve for the United States. Sometimes military necessity in the view of a Union commander might be we pick up and leave and you don't get to come. And maybe you set up a store, you know, maybe you've set up a home with your children. We can't help that we're gone, and who knows when, you know, they'll be back. So that upheaval is really difficult for folks. So the overall task for enslaved people at the conclusion of this conflict is to try to figure out what to do next. You know, if we said that Arkansas's ground is envisioned by whites as a place where slavery is going to assist them in making this civilized agricultural haven. And if we said enslaved people push back against that, it's not the agricultural 19th century world that they are pushing back against. If you look at the WPA ex-slave interviews, you find people identifying as an Arkansan, as a country person, as a farmer, okay? It's being withheld from the profits of their own labor. It's the power structure that they have a problem with. So a lot of people will stick around, okay, on acreage that they know in a neighborhood that's familiar to them and make a place, engage in placemaking, right? Making something, not just a place to live, but a home. Other people say, forget it, right? And they take off. And one of my favorite little sort of snippets of evidence from the National Archives are these folks who petition federal officials. And there's like 200 or so of them from around Fort Smith. And they are petitioning federal officials and saying, back us, loan us farm implements and send us out on public land in the West and we'll pay you back. But putting words in their mouth, but this is essentially what they're saying. We subscribe to 19th century ideas about landed independence. We need it outside of this power structure, right? And so the last thing I'll say about this, and this is sort of like the kind of, you know, bummer of an ending, okay, for the book, is that yes, of course, you know, slavery, chattel slavery as we know it, okay, as it existed then, ends. But labor exploitation, that contest over who gets to use acreage in what ways and has power over a crop and that kind of thing, of course, that continues. The commitment to white supremacy that had driven so many whites to pull their state out of the United States of America and into this little rogue nation, that doesn't disappear just because the Confederacy ceases to exist, right? So you've still got that going on. In another interesting, perhaps irony, Arkansas in the 1880s, 1890s becomes a place where Black Southerners from other places like the Carolinas are migrating to, because there is that perception that land is more easily had, okay, that people are have a bit more freedom, okay, to farm independently without interference. That's not exactly true, but I think you should read what Story McEnron wrote in the Arkansas Historical Quarterly, maybe 2012, 2013-ish, about this to see like sort of the ideas about that. I guess this, the long story then, is that the contest continues, okay? What is this ground gonna mean? Who has power over it? What does agriculture in Arkansas look like, okay? And sort of what's the legacy of what these people had to endure? And so shamelessly, I'm gonna just put the discount code back up. We've got a pen if somebody wants me to sign books when we're finished here, but what I want to do is end this slideshow and see if there are questions in the chat for me.
Went down to the River Jordan, where John baptized three. When I walked the devil in hell, says Johnny baptized me. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Oh, now roll, Jordan, roll. My soul will rise in heaven, Lord, for the year old Jordan, roll. Well, some say John was a Baptist. Some say John was a Jew. But I say John was a preacher, cause my Bible says so too. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul will rise in heaven, Lord, for the year of Jordan, roll.